Okay. Yes, there are prints up at the front here, so... actually, if you could put some of these prints at the back and then people coming in can collect them, that's great. Thank you very much indeed. So, I want to widen out this whole question of gender a little bit. Just focusing on women is, well, obviously it's important, but in order to focus on it, we need to be able to think about broader issues of gender and gender identity. There's a big debate about Shakespeare himself. It's not necessarily a question of whether he was gay as such, although there are indications that, well, we'll take a look, all right? And then we'll see how that fits in with early modern understanding of gender and male-female relationships. We can see him in different ways. There's a lot of debate about him. Is he a chauvinist, you know, opposed to women, a woman hater? Is he a proto-feminist? I mean, it really depends on how you look at some of what he wrote. And it also depends on, you know, what part of his writings you look at, because there's an awful lot in Shakespeare. So, just sort of relating that to the general position of women in the early modern period. So, trying to do quite a lot here with this presentation. Let's get started and see how it goes. What I just said. Okay, it's a more or less that's the message. Okay, if we're going to discuss improperly. We need to look at the broader gender issues and gender roles. Staring with the question of Shakespeare's own sexuality. I'm supposed to say starting, of course. Okay, so there's a little typo there on the first. Okay, on the first slide. And I'd like to begin by looking at one of Shakespeare's sonnets, sonnet number 20. I'll go through it. This is how it was originally published in the early 17th century. This is what it would have looked like on the page. So we'll look at it like that, and then I'll show it to you kind of translated, as it were, into more modern English, so you can perhaps understand a little bit more easily. But what Shakespeare wrote was this: "A woman's face, with nature's own hand painted, hast thou, the master mistress of my passion. A woman's gentle heart, but not acquainted with shifting change, as is false women's fashion. And I, more bright than theirs, less false in rowling, guiding the object whereupon it gazeth. A man in hue, all hue, in his controlling, which steals men's eyes and women's souls amazeth. And for a woman, wert thou first created, till nature, as she wrought thee, fell a-doting, and by addition me of thee defeated. By adding one thing, to my purpose nothing. But since she picked thee out for women's pleasure, mine be thy love, and thy love's use their treasure." As I say, going through that, firstly I'd like to pick out the master mistress of my passion. We saw the man-female thing going on in pamphlets from that period, didn't we, last week? We got it again there in Shakespeare, the master mistress. We've got this little expression at the end, "she pricked thee out for women's pleasure." It's a gardening metaphor. When we sow seeds in the garden, too many come up in one place, and so we prick out the extra ones. We prick them out. That's the expression, okay? We take them out. But Shakespeare's using it here as a pun. I don't know how good or how vulgar your English slang is, but you may know that the word prick as an expression for penis, even in Shakespeare's day. Okay, I was quite surprised by that, actually, because I thought it was a modern slang. It's not. Okay, it goes back hundreds of years, and Shakespeare's using it there. "She pricked thee out" means she gave you a penis, okay, for women's pleasure, okay? So he's using the gardening metaphor, but he's using it as a wordplay, so it has the two meanings. She chose you for women's pleasure, or she gave you a penis for women's pleasure. It has both meanings. So let's go through it two lines by two lines, every couplet together. You, the master mistress of my passion, you have a woman's face painted with nature's own hand. Now it's clear that this must be addressed to a man. The master mistress. You have a woman's face, all right, and you have the gentle heart of a woman, but you don't know the shifting change that's common with false women. You're more reliable, you're more trustworthy than they are. Okay, you don't know the shifting change that is common with false women. If we're thinking about typical anti-woman statements, this sort of false women and the idea that women are false and not to be trusted, it's something we talked about last week. And it comes here in this poem. Your eye is brighter than theirs, but not as falsely roving. So you don't kind of look around, kind of catching everybody's eyes, saying, "Hey, don't you like me?" Basically, this is what the sort of mistrust that a woman gives the glad eye to everybody in this poem of Shakespeare. So that's what he's accusing women of. That they look at men in a flirting kind of way. And your eye lights up the objects that it looks upon. So you've got a bright eye like a woman's, but it's more to be trusted than a woman's eye. You're a man in appearance, one who controls all others, who catches the attention of men and the souls of women. Okay, so, you are a man, all right? This person that's being addressed is being contrasted with women, and is a man in appearance who catches the attention of men and the souls of women. Everybody looks at you, okay? Clearly a very handsome man. You were made to be a woman until nature, as she made you, fell in love with you. And nature, of course, is female, right? We talk about Mother Nature. Nature is she. So nature fell in love with you. So because nature fell in love with you, she gave you something that she could love you with. Okay? She gave you that penis. Okay, by addition, me of thee defeated. She made it impossible for me to win you by adding something that was quite unsuitable to my purpose. All right, she chose you to be for the pleasure of women. Let's take the less slangy translation there. She chose you, or she gave you a penis. All right, if we're going to be very frank about it, to be for the pleasure of women. So may your love be for me, even if the act of loving you is for them. Well, that's an interesting, the whole thing is obviously about the poet's attraction towards a man, but he doesn't cross a certain line, does he? May your love be for me, even if the act of loving you is for them. Right? I love you, but I'm not going to sleep with you. I'm not going to have sex with you. The act of loving you. The act is for women to do with you. It's not for me to do that. So there are lots of sonnets by Shakespeare that are addressed to a man. And clearly Shakespeare greatly admired this man, and clearly there was a sexual component to it. But, whether it crosses the line into homosexuality is difficult to say. We said that the early modern period was more open about sexuality than the Victorian period of the 19th century, which you're probably more used to. But would it have been that open that he could openly say that he was sexually attracted to this man, or that he wanted to sleep with him, or that he had slept with him? I don't think so. We don't find the early modern period being that open. Homosexuality was criminalized. It was regarded very, very negatively. He would get himself into trouble if he wrote a sonnet that suggested that he actually crossed that line from liking this man, even loving him. If we go back to Plato, all right, Plato, Platon, from the ancient Greek times, he felt that the most important love, the greatest love, was the love between men. But it was not sexual. Sex is for something you do with women, but you can't really love women. I mean, you can have sex with them, but that's it, really. So he had that sort of narrow view women were all right for the physical thing, but real love was a sort of mental process, being able to share the same mind with somebody. And for Plato, that could only happen between men. Or he didn't think about it about women, but presumably women could find the same sort of satisfaction by mentally connecting with each other. I don't know. But the point is that all of this kind of thinking from Greek times, Plato and so on, was very much talked about in Shakespeare's time. The whole Renaissance was kind of getting Greek texts like Plato or Latin texts and translating them and making them part of popular debate. I mean, that was an important part of the Renaissance. So obviously he's kind of connected with all of that, and the idea that the most perfect relationship, the closest and deepest relationship, would be between men. And that was, so in that sense, Shakespeare is staying completely inside what's conventional for his time. And if somebody turned around and said, "Hey, Billy, you're gay," he would say, no, it's all platonic. All right, it's all about, you know, the relationship of the mind. The act of sex is with the woman. All right, but the actual love is between men. Okay, so that he would, you know, this would not, you know, it's very kind of, it's close to, it's playing with gender identities and homosexuality. It's getting very close to a sort of physical relationship between two men, but it's not going that far. All right, so it's important to understand that in the early modern period, and really until fairly recently, it was not possible to talk in terms of physical relationships between people of the same sex. So, okay, there you have it. There's Shakespeare's Sonnet 20. Say there are many others among his sonnets that are addressed apparently to men. Now, it's pretty certain that these sonnets were published without Shakespeare's permission. And just from the fact that they were published without his permission indicates that they give a good insight into what he really felt and thought. If he'd given his permission, he might have said, "Yeah, but not that one. No, not that one, okay? Or let me change this a little bit, if it's going to be published, okay?" Somebody took them and published them without his permission, so there's no sort of self-censorship from the author. He hasn't had a chance to cut out or change anything that he thought was not suitable for general publication. They had actually circulated among his friends in manuscript for some years before that. He'd passed them around among his friends, and somehow a copy had got into the hands of someone who decided to publish them. And there are 154 of them, and the first 126 appear to be addressed to a man. And as I say, it's very often difficult to tell whether they're intended platonically, that is, you know, in Platon, Plato's kind of philosophy of a sort of mental or intellectual relationship, or whether they indicate a sexual relationship or at least sexual attraction. It's something that scholars debate about, you know. Also, the sonnets are dedicated to someone with the initials WH, so there's speculation about who WH would have been. That the man he admired was either Henry Wriothesley, the Earl of Southampton, or William Herbert, the third Earl of Pembroke. These were both patrons of Shakespeare. In those days, how did someone like Shakespeare manage to write? He would find a rich, upper-class person who would say, "Well, I'll pay your rent. You know, I'll look after you, you know, because I think what you're doing is great." So that would be a patron. And most writers from that period had to seek a patron, unless they were independently rich. You know, if they were high class themselves and very rich themselves, they could just write. But Shakespeare did not come from a very rich family or anything. In fact, his father got into trouble with money. So he would have needed somebody to support him financially. So both of these men gave him support. And the man he admired may have been this one. or this one? Okay, I'll give you a clearer look at them in a minute. Okay. Yeah. All right. Could be either of those. All right. Again, scholars debate about who it actually was. So, you know, as I say, the question of whether he's gay is sort of up in the air there. He's implying attraction to men in a lot of his works, but whether that's a sexual attraction or not, well, that's a different matter. There's a, you know, any culture, there's a line between homosexuality and homosocial bonding. And homosocial behavior, where people of the same sex get together and bond, is not considered to be the same as homosexuality. In fact, it's not the same. I mean, if you go to the hot, every country is different. If you go to the hot spring, you get naked with a whole bunch of people who are of the same sex as you. Nobody considers it to have anything to do with sex, particularly. Okay. In other countries, people might think that was very strange. Well, they would. Okay, because it just doesn't happen. It doesn't happen in my culture, for example. Okay. So what exactly would be the limits in Shakespeare's time, again, is something that we can sort of think about and it's open to debate. And also, you have to think that poetry and drama are, you know, they're not necessarily, I mean, they can be written as a kind of fiction. They're not necessarily written as a sort of fact about the writer. You know, writers can imagine themselves in certain positions. We don't suppose that Shakespeare was suicidal just because Hamlet talks about suicide, do we? Okay? So we wouldn't have to suppose that he was gay, even though he writes about homosexual love, or if assuming that that's what it is. Okay? So it's not something we clearly claim in one direction or another. And of course, Shakespeare was married. You know, and he had a daughter, and not that that necessarily proves anything. But the other point that I want to make is, well, what the heck would it matter anyway? Shakespeare isn't famous because of whether he's gay or straight, or because of whether he's a Catholic or a Protestant, or a lot of the other things that people debate about him. He's famous because of what he wrote. Okay, that's what makes him famous. And James Joyce, you know, wrote back in 1916 in his Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. He wrote, "The artist, like the god of creation, remains within or behind or beyond or above his handiwork, invisible, refined out of existence, indifferent, paring his fingernails. The writing of an author is, you know, separate from the author. The author has they get up in the morning and they have breakfast and they." You know, do the things that they do, but their writing is separate from that. It's independent of that. And we get the idea of the death of the author. Roland Barthes wrote a very famous paper in 1968 called La Mort de l'Auteur. And again, he's making the same point. Once a work is published, the author as such is not really important. It's the relationship between the text and the reader. Okay, so what does this text mean to you? What does it say to you? And that's the wonderful thing, really, about literature and about being students of literature. That most language learning is based on what does it mean, whereas literature is based on what does it mean to you. You have the chance to make your relationship with the text. Okay, that's the fascination of literature. Okay, that you make your own relationship with it. And it's not just, oh, it means this, you know, according to the dictionary. But it means this to me. To me, it will always, you know, have this association, this connection, this particular meaning. So we think about it like that, then it doesn't really matter what his sexuality might or might not have been. What matters is what his works tell us about sexuality, what his works tell us about gender issues. Not what he felt, but what he makes his readers feel. What sorts of issues are being brought up in Shakespeare? How does he deal with gender? How does he deal with gender issues? Okay, so that's what I'd like to move on and try to focus on in the next part of the presentation. Okay, so generally the whole question of gender and the Elizabethan stage, it's a, as we said, I think mentioned last week, all of the female actors would have been acted by men at that time, so that obviously, you know, has a big influence on the way that we see, particularly the drama. All the female parts were acted by boys or young men. Well, when I say young men, I'm assuming young females, because older females would have been acted by older men. But those attractive women, you know, that would have been boys or very young men. And so that's another possibility that some people will argue in relation to Shakespeare himself. He might have just felt that those males, when they were dressed up as women, were more attractive than any actual women. You know, that woman as she is up on the stage is, you know, for him, that's a perfect woman. But he knows that actually it's not a woman. So it's a paradox for him. So, but again, I'm getting back, I'm still talking about what Shakespeare, what his sexuality might have been. I want to move away from that. So let's move on to, not to what he may or may not have felt, but looking at his works and what his works are actually telling us. Having male characters taking female parts was something that was outside his control. Obviously, that was just the convention of the age. It wasn't something that he was doing. But on the other hand, he really does get into it all in a big way, more than most dramatists. He really gets into the cross-dressing of characters. So you don't just have, you know, men dressed up as women playing female parts on Shakespeare's stage. You get men dressed up as women playing female parts, and those females then take on a male identity. Okay? So he really kind of plays around with the whole thing, you know, so that these women, for various reasons, dress up as men. All right? Okay, in The Merchant of Venice, for example, you've got Portia dressed as a judge and her maid dressed as an apprentice. Okay? So they are actually women, but they've dressed up as men in order to take on a men's role, because a woman could not function as a judge at that time, so she's taking on a man's role in order to take on the part of a judge in that story. And in the same play, Shylock's daughter Jessica disguises herself as a boy in order to run off with her Christian lover. Okay, so you get a lot of this in Shakespeare. Perhaps the most striking example is in Twelfth Night, Viola. She doesn't just disguise as a man, she disguises as a eunuch. A eunuch was a castrated man, a man who didn't have, to put it bluntly, didn't have any balls, didn't have any testicles. Okay? This was still going on in the early modern period. Less and less, but it was still going on. Boys who had particularly, I mean, the main reason it would happen was in the context of boys who had particularly beautiful voices. Okay? When their voice dropped, when their voice broke, as they reached puberty, as they reached the age of 14 or 15 or whatever, their voice would break. Okay, so to prevent that from happening, some of these poor boys had their testicles removed. Okay, and she presents herself as a eunuch, as a man who has no testicles. Okay, She, of course, behind that disguise, she is a woman. And she falls in love with the Duke. But the Duke thinks she's a man. And so she's kind of getting a bit confused about why this man is trying to get so close to her, to him. Sorry, I'm getting confused now. So, and also, the Countess Olivia thinks that she's a man, thinks that Viola is a man, and consequently falls in love with the man that she thinks Viola is. Okay, so it's happening both ways round. What doesn't happen in Shakespeare is that people see through the disguise. Okay, somehow their heart speaks their true desire, but they can't they can't see through Orsino never imagines that he does feel attracted to this man, because as far as he can see, it's the man. He doesn't fall in love with men. Okay. And again, Olivia assumes that it's a man and therefore falls in love with Viola. In Afra Ben's story that we talked a little bit about last week, we get the difference that even though it's a woman dressed up as a man still falls in love with her. Even though apparently it's a man, the man falls in love with the other man. As far as the man is concerned, it's a man. Even though really it's a woman. But Shakespeare never crosses that line. Shakespeare never goes there. It's always like, no, the people on the stage will only see the disguise. They will only see the disguised sex. They won't guess or imagine that the person is anything other than their apparent sex as presented on the stage. Now, we talked last week about the woman taking on the man's role and how threatening that was in the early modern period, how it led to kind of male anxiety and so on. You've got other plays of Shakespeare where this sort of thing is going on, women dress as men. And we've got men dressing as women, much more unusual. As I said last week, though, that wasn't considered to be so bad. I mean, men dressing as women was seen as more as a sort of bit of fun or something. Women dressing as men was seen as much more serious. We do get one or two examples. In the Greek myth of Hercules, obviously, very masculine sort of paradigm of masculinity, was forced to wear the clothing of Queen Omphale and to serve her. It may have been that's what influences Shakespeare to have Antony dress as a woman in Antony and Cleopatra. Okay? But usually it's not that way around. One important point here would be, what was the intention of the woman in dressing as a man? Was she trying to take a man's position? Was she trying to kind of, take on masculinity? Or is she doing it because circumstances are forcing her and her femininity at heart is still there? That would make the difference. That's why Viola, for example, there's no disapproval of Viola because she's doing what she has to do. So circumstances have put her in this situation. It's not subversive. It's not challenging masculinity, what she's doing. But there are women who challenge and take on, usurp the man's role. You've got Katharina in The Taming of the Shrew. You've got Portia in Julius Caesar. You've got Lady Macbeth in Macbeth. These last two are quite similar to each other. They're taking on the sort of male identity. Portia kills herself at the end of the play in Julius Caesar and says, "I have a man's mind, but a woman's might." And Lady Macbeth, who actually goes mad and dies, she says, "Unsex me here. Okay, take away my female sex," asking to lose her womanly qualities of kindness and compassion, and take on cruelty, which was seen to be a masculine thing. And both women encourage their husbands to murder the king or the leader of the country. And they're kind of wearing the trousers, not just physically, but psychologically. They're taking on the male kind of role. Okay, this sort of paradigm of the woman taking on the man's role is, and look, there she is putting on a crown here in this picture. This was the, this is what men feared, the women kind of taking over or challenging the traditional men's role. Okay, so let's take a look now a little bit at women in Shakespeare's actual period. Give me a minute here. I think there may be one or two things that will not the sound. Okay. Right. So, yeah, I keep saying it's, you know, it's not Shakespeare's own sexual identity that we need to be particularly worried about here or concerned about. What we need to be thinking about is what he's expressing about gender in terms of the society and in terms of male-female relationships, you know, generally. What's he saying about human nature? We've got Henry VIII divorcing from his first wife and breaking away from the Roman Catholic Church back in the earlier part of the 16th century, before Shakespeare was born. And he wanted a son, you know, to take the throne, but it was his two daughters who actually would have the big influence, as we saw last week, on the development of the 16th century, and their main rivals, Lady Jane Grey and Mary Queen of Scots, were also women. So that psychologically had an important impact on the way that society in those days saw women. Henry's son died. He died when he was 15 years old, he chose Lady Jane Grey to be his successor. But she I think I put 11 days. I think it's nine days. I think it, anyway, just over a week. I think it should be 9 days, not 11. She was deposed after 9 days in favour of Henry VIII's elder daughter. And then after Mary died, it was Elizabeth. So, you know, we have that sort of background. And Mary, Queen of Scots, being the main challenger for the crown after after Elizabeth became the queen. And, yeah, Henry, who was so keen to have a son, he would probably have been really, you know, what? I'm very taken aback to think that that's how things worked out. Okay, here. I think I showed them to you last week, but because they're so important, I'm sort of going over some of the ground a little bit again. Okay, these very central women in the 16th century. I've got it 11 there again. I'm pretty sure it should be 9. I'll have to check that. Anyway, there they are, these four important women, and women as martyrs as well. This was a time when people could be put to death for their beliefs. Queen Mary, in particular, put hundreds of Protestants to death. And his own cousin, Shakespeare's own cousin, was hanged, drawn, and quartered for harbouring a priest. And these people who died, particularly the women who died for their Protestant beliefs in the time of Henry and Mary, were especially kind of remembered as martyrs. Anne Askew was tortured and burned under Henry VIII. And Shakespeare probably had her in mind when he wrote of the death of Lavinia in Titus and Andronicus. You know, he would be thinking of the suffering of Anne Askew when he wrote Lavinia's death. But it's not so much, you know, did he think about those martyrs in creating his own characters. What it's really about is the whole way that the female male identity was recast and perceived in the early modern period. The fact that these women faced their deaths with such courage was used as a kind of political tool with which to shame men. Okay, can't you even, you know, can't you? You're not being burned to death like Anne Askew, you know. Can't you even sort of accept, you know, a little bit of suffering? Okay, so the government would sort of abuse the society by saying, look, you know, these women, they put up with those things. Why, what's wrong with you? Why can't you just accept these things? So the message being that if these women could suffer so bravely, men didn't have any right to complain, even if they were being abused by the government, by the state. So, you know, there's a sort of irony that if you're going to be a real man, you had to suffer like a woman. And you have the, not just the martyrs, but things like the pains of childbirth. Remember, having a child in those days was a pretty dangerous thing. Lots of women died in childbirth. And, what we said last week about how the age of heroic knights and male heroism seemed to be dead. And men were no longer rescuing damsels and maidens in distress from dragons and so on. So they were being threatened rather by masculine women and feeling about it. And so we get witches. I'm showing a flame burning here, and we often think of witches being burned, which they were in most parts of Europe. Actually, in England, they were hanged. We do once again seem to have trouble with volume. It may be something on my settings here, and I may have to have some help to work out what's going on, why the sounds aren't coming out. I think it looks as if it might be something to do with my computer and its settings. I don't quite know how to do it, and I'm going to need that later on. So, I'll worry about that later on. Witches may seem like harmless fun now, but in those days, people really believed it. Okay, and we've got in the 1580s, which would be, you know, very much in Shakespeare's time, you've got 64 people tried as witches, 53 of whom were found guilty and hanged. Nearly all of them women. In nearly all these cases of witchcraft were women. And King James, you know, he believed in witches. I think we had that question coming up last week. You know, why did it take off so much? Well, because the king was a believer in witches and wrote a book about them at the beginning of the 17th century. That was kind of why belief in witchcraft was sort of taking off at that time. And so we tend in modern scholarship to see witchcraft as basically a form of violence against women. We see the witch hunts as reflecting a deep-seated fear of women in early modern society. And, yeah, to a certain extent, it comes from the Christian doctrine that it was Eve who was tempted by the snake, and Eve who then tempted Adam, and women were supposed to be much more carnal. In that sonnet of Shakespeare's, it's women who look with a flirting eye at men, all right? It was women's fault. You know, we've only just come round in the 21st century to saying, well, look, just because the woman wore a short skirt, it didn't mean that she was advertising that she could be raped. You know, but the tendency to blame the victim, it's her fault. If she dresses like that, what should she expect? Not the man, Okay, in some countries it's still they're blaming the victim in that way. Okay, men can't be expected to control themselves. You know, it's the woman's fault. So blaming the woman was sort of really it was just normal, and in fact that probably continued to be fairly normal until the late 20th century. So women were partly because of the connections with menstruation, it happens every month, and that's connected with the moon. And so the moon is connected with spirits and supernatural. And so there was this sort of popular fear that somehow women were more inherently susceptible to evil than men were, and that evil was likely to come in through women. As I say, in England, they were actually hanged. I put it in as a fun fact. That's supposed to be ironic. Not much fun about any of this. You'll have seen that picture from last week's presentation. So this is a 17th century engraving. Here's another one for you. One of the tests to prove whether a woman was a witch, or any person indeed, but usually a woman was a witch, was to strip the victim naked, tie her up, and throw her into a river. If she floated, she was a witch, because the natural thing would be to sink. So if she floated, she'd still be alive, and then they'd take her away and hang her because she was a witch. If she drowned, she wasn't a witch, but she'd be dead. Okay, so there was no escape. I mean, sometimes they managed to pull a drowning woman out and save her life and say, oh, you're okay, you're safe now, we found that you're not a witch. But very often she'd be dead by the time they got her out of the water. So it would be like, oh, we're very sorry, but you are innocent, so you will have gone to heaven, so it's all right, really. So this is the kind of cruelty that was going on at that time. Okay, it's very much, it's very much a sort of inflicting suffering on women, making women suffer. Okay, it's very much that's what it's all about. Okay, and there's a tremendous amount of it going on at this time. Okay, so it's and I'm a bit worried that, so no, it's not fun, okay? We don't believe in witches today, and people don't get burned because they believe something different from us, but that was going on in Shakespeare's time, and if we want to understand, you know, his works, we have to understand the context. We need to understand the social context of the time. Okay. Finally, then, let's just put one or two bits and pieces together. You've got this situation where male hegemony was being challenged by powerful women. You've got brave women who are putting men to shame. And you've got a belief that women are evil. I think if you take those three points, that sort of explains an awful lot of the psychology of the attitude towards women that you get in the literature of the period. At the same time, you've got relationships. Sometimes people write about the early modern period saying, was there anybody who actually sort of was happily married, you know, and just happily had a relationship, you know, between a man and a woman? Was it always constant war between the male and female sexes at that time? Well, you know, no, it wasn't constant war. There were people who, you know, made sort of satisfactory relationships and lived normal lives. And that is also reflected in the literature, but there's a tremendous amount of, war between the sexes going on in the literature of this period. And there are lots of other aspects of gender that we could look at in relation to Shakespeare's work, but I'm not going to emphasize, or I wouldn't want to emphasize, what it says about the author, because, like I say, that to me doesn't really matter. It's what this author has said about his period, what this author has said about human nature, what this author says about the world that we live in. That matters, okay? But whether he was gay or not, or whether he had eggs for breakfast, doesn't really matter very much to me. And so, again, I would come to a general point about literature here. I would say that in great literature, we don't get answers. Okay? That's not what literature is about. I don't like literature that sets out to give people the answers to things. You know, it's sort of pushing a religious message or a moral message at me. I prefer literature that says, look, look at these paradoxes, look at this complexity of life. What do you think? Okay, so that kind of literature does enable us to develop a relationship. It's asking us to think about things. And I think that's really what great literature does. I think that's why we are still reading Shakespeare, because he's encouraging us to ask the questions. Okay? He's not giving us the answers. That would be too boring, too limiting. People who think they know the answers are very often not really particularly interesting. So what fascinates us is that he can show us all of these aspects of human relations. He can make us think about our own attitudes, our own assumptions. Life is different for us now, okay? But he's still talking about the same things that existed then. Gender relations existed then just like they exist now. For example, all the kinds of problems of his age exist now. So it's not his sexuality, it's the window that he opens onto the way relationships were seen in those days that really, I think, is the point. Okay, so yes, I would encourage you, if you're interested in gender relations in Shakespeare, I would encourage you to take a look at these things. That's it, really. That's the end of the presentation. Okay.